Good morning, everyone. Today's scripture reading is a familiar passage from Matthew. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all of his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass, the field, which is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for all these things. And indeed, your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. May these words be to us our light and our life. So good morning, everybody. I'm Lee Schaefer. I've been a part of this community for about 16 years. Thank you for the opportunity to talk today. I always thought the amateurs talked from over there, but Adam said I should be here. We have a fine tradition of lay preaching in our church. I want to set appropriate expectations, however. Turns out writing a good sermon is not as easy as it looks. And my topic today is happiness, which I sometimes write about in the Star Tribune, but you should know I've been working on this topic for a long time. I got my start trying to help my business partner get more marketing assignments, and without any marketing expertise of my own, I used buzzwords in conversations, concepts like cognitive bias and choice architecture. It was mostly nonsense, but I had read a lot about happiness. And one of the interesting things I've read in nearly 10 years of amateur research is how happiness changes throughout our lifetime. If you ain't happy now, just wait. The psychologist Daniel Gilbert wrote a bestseller about this, and he had a chart that showed that happiness dips in middle age and then recovers as you get older. Lots of studies have proven the same things. Your happiness goes down at the birth of your first child, recovers a little bit when your child is in elementary school, and then sinks to the depths when your children are teenagers. This is fact. Happiness doesn't really recover until your kids move out. So, graduates, here is the inconvenient truth. You've been making your parents miserable. The other point I took away about happiness over time is how we humans are very resilient. We tend to bounce, our happiness bounces back even after terrible events. You know, I've often said that I live a tragedy-free life, but I was reminded by my big brother that my mom was killed in a car accident when I was 19. I was a student across the street. I came back from the funeral and tried to finish the term, and I ended up so sick I was in the ER. My father later apologized to me for not coming to McAllister to take me home, but he wasn't aware of how sick I was because he was sick with grief himself. The point of the story, though, is that within 2 years, he was remarried, and he lived very happily with his wife for more than 20 years. That's the way we're wired. We do bounce back. Another interesting finding, and the good news for all of us here, is that there's a whopping difference in reported happiness between people who are highly religious and everybody else. This is not Christianity Today magazine poll. This is the Pew Charitable Trust. People who report themselves to be highly religious, about half of them think of themselves as highly satisfied with their lives. For everybody else, it's more like 29%. And you can also pick up on this if you read about people who think that their faith has seeped away. They think of it as something that they've lost that's really important to them. One of the saddest things I've ever read was an essay in the New York Times about a mom who observed her son deal with their daddy being in Iraq. And she had accidentally let him watch a news item about how dangerous it was, and she saw him bow his head and pray. And she was amazed that a seed of faith had somehow germinated in her family. Meanwhile, the only prayer she could muster is, "Help thou my unbelief." She envied her son. Also, I think one of the biggest things I took away from all my reading is that we humans also have a lot of mental biases that get in the way of our happiness. These are hardwired into our circuitry. A lot of them seem to have developed back in our evolutionary past. A great example is a so-called negativity bias, and it's the tendency to remember bad things that happened more than we remember the good things that happened. And the research now seems to suggest this is about how we stayed in tune with threats. We can't remember the picnic, but we can sure remember the low rumble of the saber-toothed tiger shortly before it pounced on our uncle. So researchers have reached this disheartening conclusion that the daily struggle to survive in our distant past gave us a default setting, that of being selfish, greedy, and anxious. So when our early ancestors saw a field of lilies, they wouldn't have paused to reflect on the beauty. They would have tried to eat them. I think that's what Jesus was talking about in this well-known passage you just heard. He was talking to a group of people, and because they were people, they were kind of anxious. What he was trying to describe for them is a life more abundant. But we have to learn how to do that. We have to teach ourselves how to do that, to switch off the default setting. As you graduates will soon find out, our world hums along just fine with everybody being a little bit self-centered, a little bit greedy, and a little bit anxious. For example, in our early marriage, Tanya and I met with a financial planner. This is back when we had more student debt than savings, but we wanted to start the process. And he was obviously trained to get us to talk about the big and expensive stuff we wanted. He got me to say I really wanted a sailboat. And at the time, I probably did. Had his goal been our happiness rather than sell some high commission mutual funds, here's the advice he should have given. Buy a smaller house than you can afford. Buy a smaller anything than you could afford. Sorry to bring money into this, but you know, Jesus talked about it too. And the fact is, in 2016, a lot of Americans live on the edge financially. Came out last week that more than two-thirds of Americans can't come up with $1,000 for an unexpected expense. And this is not people who are poor. These are people who make in excess of $100,000 a year. They just live on the edge. So saving a little money is a good place to start. To feel better about it, but I think it's more fundamental than that. We have to change the way we think about the money we have. People at Thrivent in Minneapolis, the big Lutheran insurance company, they've been thinking about this for a long time. And Thrivent's CEO once showed me what happens with donations and volunteer time on a chart. There's a big chart. At one end was a set of columns for people who said they were barely getting by. And at the other end, there was a set of columns for how much they gave away and how much they volunteered for people who described themselves as being in surplus, which is a great concept. It doesn't mean financially secure. It means in surplus. It means having more than enough. And it is no surprise that the donations for the people who described themselves as in surplus was about 7% of pre-tax income. And they volunteered in excess of 20 hours a month, which is a lot. But the interesting thing is these people were not rich. To the contrary, two-thirds of the people with household income under $60,000 describe themselves as being either secure or in surplus. So the next place Thrivent's going with this research is trying to figure out, what followed what. These people who describe themselves in surplus, they're beyond secure. They're not fretting about the future. They have money to give away. They're happy. So was the feeling of having more than enough that led to an increase in giving money away, or was it the other way around? That is, what if giving money away, making that choice and making that part of your daily life and sticking to it, what if that leads to an increase in feelings of financial security and stability? In other words, what if giving money away makes us happier? They're still trying to figure that out. I think they're on a great track. What we do know, what's been proven time after time in studies, is that buying more stuff doesn't work. So here's a tip. Beware of the Lexus effect. The Lexus effect gets its name from the luxury car, and the precise term is hedonic adaptation, or the hedonic treadmill. Basically, it's like this. If you get a great new car, at first you really like it, but the positive effect on your happiness just doesn't last very long. It just becomes a car. And the science is clear. People adapt to having a nice thing. But here's the really weird part. Even though the car doesn't make you happy, if you lose the car because of some financial setback, that can make you miserable. That's called loss aversion. So think about this for a minute. Getting the thing doesn't make you happy, but losing the thing makes us miserable. So based on that, it is astounding to me that Americans buy $100 billion of luxury cars every year. It should be about zero. So there's just been a stack of studies on this. It's foolish to put your value in pretty much anything you buy. The new house, the latest iPhone, none of it really works to make you happy long term. There's even evidence out there that having nice things leads us to act more selfishly. One study documented that the nicer the car, the more likely it was to roll through a pedestrian intersection without stopping. Another study, I like this one, 44,000 people. The higher the income, the more likely you were to have shoplifted. Then there was a study that observed test subjects leaving a psychology lab after running some experiments. They were unaware that the real experiment was to observe their behavior when they left the lab. When they left the lab, they had to walk by a table. They had a jar of candy, and the sign said the candy is for kids. The higher the income, the more likely it was that the adults swiped candy from the jar. This was not a study about happiness, but it doesn't take a genius to figure out that if you take candy from kids, you're probably not very secure or happy. Okay, so if this stuff that we get by doesn't make us happy, what will? And so here's tip number three, invest your time and money in people. A meal with friends always tops the surveys of the most pleasurable things in life. And there are other ways to invest in people. Volunteering clearly works. Let me talk to you a little bit about this thing I'm wearing on my wrist. These are the things you get from a mission trip, if you're an adult going on a mission trip. I've been on 8. This is the first time I've worn all 8 ever. In fact, it took me a while to find them today. But I go on mission trips not because the youth need me. I go on mission trips because I need the youth. Now let's just keep that down, okay? But that is the reason to do that. I don't go on mission trips because the people of New Jersey needed me. I go on mission trips because the people in I needed the people in New Jersey. There are other kinds of experiences that can make you happy, and they're not expensive things like a trip or concerts. It's teaching a nephew to fly a kite. If you stayed up late to take your kids to the latest Star Wars movie at the 12 o'clock midnight show, throw the ticket stub in a drawer. When you find it in a year, you'll relive the pleasurable experience, having forgotten that you slept through the whole movie. And again, we have to teach ourselves to be grateful for these kinds of things, these very wonderful and rich experiences. Unfortunately, there's a goofy default setting getting in the way of our being grateful. It's a well-known bias that causes people to think they deserve the good things they have in life. And this leads us to both underappreciate the good things we have, as well as it convinces us that we deserve even more good things. So one of my favorite studies came from Cal Berkeley, and it was about undergraduates who were brought in to discuss some problem on the campus. It was described by the writer Michael Lewis. So there were 4 people in the group, and one was randomly assigned to be the facilitator just before the discussion started. Then, halfway through the discussion, the group was given a snack, 5 cookies on a plate. Some of you might have already guessed the point of the study. 4 students, 5 cookies. The researchers had no interest in what they were talking about. They observed what happened to the 5th cookie. And the facilitator, randomly chosen just minutes before, invariably ate the 5th cookie. So that they did this different ways. They did it with men, they did it with women, they did it with native-born, they did it with immigrant students. Same result. The randomly chosen facilitator felt that they deserved the 5th cookie. Well, we here have all been handed the extra cookie. Everybody in this sanctuary is lucky. Lucky to be here on this lovely Sunday morning, lucky to have the parents we've had, lucky to have the friends we've had, lucky to be part of our church community, lucky to be surrounded by the love of God. For you graduates, you will be faced with many more opportunities and many more extra cookies. In time, you will find it easy to think you somehow deserved the 5th cookie. The world will be a lot better off if you can remember your teaching here at our church and at least share the extra cookie. And of course, if you do that, you'll be a lot happier. Amen.